Our next speaker is Dr. Bhavin Jankharia. He'll be speaking on why every doctor needs to be a patient advocate. Dr. Jankharia is a consulting radiologist at Jankharia Imaging, now SRL Diagnostics, Jankharia Imaging. He's a trustee, Radiology Education Foundation. He's president-elect, Indian Radiology and Imaging Association. He's an MBBS and DMRD from Mumbai University, and also an MD Radiology from same place. His subspecialty interests are in chest, bone, cardiac radiology, and interventional CT and MRI. He's authored 2 books, he's written 20 chapters, 35 articles, given more than 500 invited lectures. He has also been the editor-in-chief at the Indian for the Indian Journal of Radiology and Imaging from 2007 to 12. And he's also a columnist for Mumbai Mirror, Man from Matunga. That's the title of his column. And that's also the URL where you can find them. Dr. Jankharia.
Thank you so much for that kind introduction. And I guess it's a late good morning to everyone. When Ajay asked me to talk about why doctors have to be patient advocates, I was struggling with the subject for a long time, and I'm still struggling with the concept. I spoke to Ajay 3 or 4 days ago, trying to understand what it is that he wanted me to speak about. And I've been here for the last 45 minutes listening to people. I've gone through the book that has been put out, and I'm getting a fair sense of where we are with this, and I will try and share that with you. Clearly, when we are talking about patient advocacy, it's not as if this is something new. This is core to the practice of medicine. That is, having people who will be the guiding forces, your people who will give you a helping hand, somebody who's a friend, philosopher and guide whenever people are not particularly well, or in maintaining wellness as a normal phenomenon. That part is clearly understood. And I think the problem that we have is that the people who we used to have, who used to do this for us, our family physicians at whatever level, clearly do not exist to any great extent today. And so we're all in a way a little adrift, not knowing exactly what we need to do. 4 days ago, I had an email from a mama of mine who lives in Jersey, which supposedly is not part of the UK, which I didn't know till then. And his daughter's partner is in Calcutta. His father had gone for a visit, landed up with acute intestinal obstruction, so the son flew into Calcutta, he's admitted in a hospital, they don't know anybody there, all the relatives are dead, there is no doctor that they know. They were in a hospital, suddenly the surgeon said we need to do a colostomy because there is obstruction or the colon can burst. He gave consent without particularly understanding what was happening. And then they told him it's probably because of a cancer in the colon. And then step by step, we need to, you know, do a biopsy, then do a PET CT, and then perhaps eventually again operate. The son freaked out. And eventually, I connected with him and tried to understand what his concerns were. And he was very nice about it. He said the doctors have been upfront and the doctors have explained things to me, but they don't have the time. And I cannot seem to ask all the questions that I would want to. That would give me the reassurance that I'm in the right place in a foreign country and that whatever is happening is fine. All he wanted from me or perhaps anybody else was the reassurance that he was in the right hands. Now, I'm in Mumbai. I have no clue who those doctors are. But given that we are a small community, I was able to get him to connect with a colleague of mine in Kolkata, and I asked him specifically to take responsibility in helping and guiding my perhaps a third cousin to get things sorted out. and I believe things are moving fine. I'm on touch with email and SMS on a daily basis, and things are getting better. This is where our family physicians or our so-called friends, philosophers and guides would have been there to bridge the gap. I know I missed Jaya's talk, and I'm sure, Jaya, you covered this in great detail. The issue of doctors being patient advocates, therefore, perhaps falls into two categories. The first is what I said. I have a friend. You're a cardiac surgeon, you have somebody in the family who has lymphoma, you have your connections, and you become the advocate for your relative to guide him or her through the process because you know the system, you know everything, you know who's good, bad, dirty, ugly, nice, etc. But I don't think that's what we are talking about here. What Ajay was trying to tell me was that every doctor, whether it's the knee replacement surgeon, or the cardiac surgeon, or a radiologist like me, needs to be a patient advocate in terms of finding the time to guide, help, and take the patient through the processes or the diseases that the patient has. And that's where I've been struggling. I can't seem to get this. For example, I do a CT-guided biopsy of a patient who has lung cancer. And the patient has cancer, and the patient comes back and discusses the issue with me. And I answer the questions that the patient has to the best of my ability, which would be restricted to issues related to diagnosis. And perhaps the next step that could be taken based upon the diagnosis. And typically the next step would be, please see your oncologist, who would be the best person to guide you in what is to happen next. I can't take more responsibility. I cannot, for example, tell the patient which oncologist to go to. And I cannot be in touch with the patient for the next 2 to 3 months trying to help that patient and figure out whether the right things are happening in the event, of course, that there is no other physician or no other advocate involved who is helping the patient. Even if the patient were to ask me upfront and say, can you please help me with the situation? Can you suggest an oncologist? I'm new to the city. I do not know what's happening. From a professional perspective, I do not think that I can break certain barriers in getting involved to a larger extent. And that is what I've been struggling with. That why I can do the best possible within my area of expertise, within the knowledge base and skill base that I have. It is extremely difficult for most of us who are now so-called technician subspecialists and technician super consultants to be able to go a little beyond. And perhaps there, more than just the advocacy, I would take this one step ahead and say that we can still create an environment where the patient feels satisfied and goes back saying that, fine, if I do have a problem later on, I might be able to lean on this doctor, even though I know for a fact that this doctor cannot be my guiding force for the entire treatment. And that perhaps, and for any doctor who's here in the audience, would be the issue of communication and empathy. A month ago, I gave the Shidori lecture to the first year batch of the US Medical College that has just entered in. And I was asked to speak to them for about 20 minutes on what it means to be a doctor and what they should expect in their journey through medical college and later on. And eventually, this is what it all boiled down to. What is it that we can do to make patients' lives easy? As Dinesh said, it's all about emotions. Yes, I have to be a skilled doctor. Yes, I have to give you the best that I have. But beyond that, there are very, very small things that we can do that I have realized make a huge difference. Asking the patient to sit down, asking them their name. When patients have come with relatives, asking them the relationships of those relatives and making them comfortable. The one question or the one statement that I make, that I'm here to answer all your questions feel free to ask as many questions as you want. Even if they are diffident, helping them with that process, and when they leave and get up, asking them once again, do you have anything else that you want to ask that you have perhaps forgotten? And I think if that is added on to the skill sets that we otherwise anyway have as good doctors, I think we've done a great job. But I will leave you with one question. The world is not black and white. Unfortunately, it's so full of grays. If you had a choice of getting operated by the best skilled surgeon in the world, with the best results, but who's a terrible human being, right? Doesn't give you the time of day, doesn't talk to you, is rude and tells you to get out of the room, versus an average surgeon with average results, but who's the best human being in the world. Eventually, it's your life, your disease, and you want to live. Who would you choose? Thank you.